Instead of going to start off the ownership on the Sura Marahim. So we're trying to understand the Surah Al-Alaq today. Okay. It's a very famous in the first Surah of Revelation. So we're just going to start off the Shaitan of the Bismillah Rahman Rahim. The Surah starts with the word Iqra. So the first word basically has the root letters of Ra and Hamza. This is an alif, basically it's a chair for the Hamza. So qara'a are the root letters, and generally the meaning is to recite. Some translators also translate as to read, okay, but the meaning is, general meaning is recite, because when we use the word qira'at or qari, that's basically the recitation. So this means to recite. And the command is made, if you have three letters word and you want to make a command out of it, what we usually do, we add an alif in the beginning with a kasra and combine these three letters, iqra, like that. Iqra is an order, it's a command. And in typically, if you have three letters, fa, ayn, and lam, if you put an alif in the beginning, it becomes if-al. That is the command, or that's the order. So this word iqra is a command. It's a command. Historically, there is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it's being revealed through Jibreel alayhi salam to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is listening. Jibreel alayhi salam is speaking and he is saying read or recite. So this is recite or read. Iqra. Okay. Now after that, the actual revelation starts. The revelation of the Quran starts after this word. So the word is basically a command and order saying recite. Now, after that is the word that starts with these three letters, Alif, Seen, and Meen. The meaning of these three letters is to give a name to someone, to assign a name, okay? And when we combine these three letters, Ismun. Ismun basically means name. Ismun is the original letter, the word, and ismun means name. Okay? So we have a word ismun, and then we have, I'm going to write down ismun, because we need to combine these two, three letters, ismun. And then the other word is Rabbun. Okay. And the another word that we need is Ka. Ismun means name. And Rabbun means Lord. And we have seen the formation of this word many times. Any noun, any name always ends up with two dhammas, the sound of noon. So this is a noun, Ismun. Has two dhammas, sound of noon. The full word is Rabbun. Okay? Rabbun means Lord or Sustainer. And there are many meanings of that. And Ka here is a pronoun. Ka means you. And this is for one person, you. Okay? Ka is, if you're pointing to someone and saying you, one person, it means Ka. Okay. So now, by the rules of the combinations, we combine first these two, Rabbun and Ka. Okay. So the meaning will be If I combine these, in English what we do, you actually put an off in between. So it becomes Lord of you. By putting an off in between two English words, the word becomes Lord of you, or in a better way we can say your Lord. Lord of you means same thing as your Lord. So the English combination will be your Lord. What we do in Arabic? In Arabic, to bring the meaning of this off, we change two dhammas into one. So this becomes Rabbu. Okay? And there is no change takes place here. So Rabbuka is the word that means your Lord. Okay? So the first combination is Rabbuka. And it is written this way together. Rabbuka, your Lord.
Usually the second word becomes kasra.
Okay, pronouns don't decline. Pronouns don't change. Only nouns change. Okay? So if you have kitabun and allahu. Allahu is the noun. It changes into allahi. Okay? But the pronouns do not change. Pronouns never change. The only time you see a change in the pronouns is the pronunciation of. But grammatically, pronouns I, you, he, she, they don't change. Okay, so they stay ka as ka. Okay? So Rabbuka is the word means your Lord. Okay? Now what we are going to do, we are going to combine this word with this word Ismun. Ismun means Lord.
Name.
Ismun means name. Sorry. Okay? And we are going to do the same thing. We are going to put now and off in between. Okay? So the English word will become name of your Lord. Okay? Name of your Lord. But what we have to do in Arabic words, two changes in the first word, ismun will change to ismu, because that's the rule. So we change this to ismu. Okay. And rabbu is the noun. So it will become rabbi. So this will become rabbi. That's the rule we have been learning, that both words have to change. The first word, two dhammas change into one. In the second word, the dhamma change to a kasra. So now the sound will become ismo rabbika. Ismo rabbika means name of your Lord. Okay? Now one more change will take place, is that B means in or with. So we are going to put the letter B in the beginning. Okay? Now, B is a harfijar. Harfijar is like a preposition, and we have been learning that if a preposition comes, it has some effect on the noun after that. And the effect is that it looks at the last letter, dhamma, and changes into a kasra. So ismo becomes ismi. Also, when we read together, we do not pronounce this alif. We say bismi. Okay? As a matter of fact, we don't even write the alif. In the other places, we have been learning that when we will see at many other places, for example, here, Allah, the alif is there, and but we left the alif there, even though we are not pronouncing, we're pronouncing Rabbi Kalladhi, but alif is left there. In this case of Ismun, there are two ways. Here it is left, but in some other places, like Bismillah, Alif is not written there. Okay. So here it is written. So this in Bismillah, you put a ba here, and you don't write. So Bismillah. Okay. So it's a very unique, but meaning does not change. Anyway, so Bismi Rabbika means in the name of your Lord. Recite in the name of your Lord. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instructing through Jibreel alayhi salam to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, recite whatever is being revealed to you, but the recitation should start with the name of your Lord. Okay, so that's the meaning so far. In the name of your Lord. Okay, and remember that this is just one person being instructed here. Ka is for one person. So the first person who is being instructed is only one person, Prophet Sallam. He is being instructed, he is being commanded, he is being ordered to recite. But the recitation or the reading is going to start with the name of your sustainer or your Lord or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Now, because he is receiving it first time, the revelation, until now he has no idea, he is not a prophet at that time. He has no idea of any revelation or anything. First time he is hearing these words. So naturally, the next thing should come in somebody's mind. What is this Rabb that is being told? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is explaining further. Okay? So let's look after that. The word after that is Allazi. Okay? Okay, so the word starts with these letters, Lam, Dal, and Ya. Lazi. Lazi means he. Okay. And when you put Al before that, Al brings the meaning of the. So we are talking about someone who is the, he, but some special he. Because the brings the meaning of someone special. And that is pointing to the word Rabb. Allazim is he, but he is pointing to the word Rabb. Then after that are these letters, Ha, La, and Qaf. Khalaqa, this means to create. Ha, La, and Qaf, root letters means to create. Okay? And by the simplest rule of grammar, if you have fa and then lam, fa'ala, to do, if you put three fathas, one on each letters, meaning becomes third person past tense. Fa'ala means he did. Okay. So to do the same thing, it becomes khalaqa. Khalaqa means he created. He created. Alladhi, he, khalaqa, created. So here, Alladhi is pointing to Rabb. He, and khalaqa means he created. But in the sentence, to make the proper English, you will write down who created. He who created. If you put down he created, the English sentence will not be very good. So instead of writing he created, you will translate it he who created. So read in the name of your Lord, he who created. Now, the other rule in the next ayat is that if you have a khalaqa, which is a verb, khalaqa is a verb, something is being done, okay? He created. Then the next word starts with these three letters, Alif, Noon, and Seen. And the noun from this is Insanun. Insanun means man. Okay. Insanun means man. When you put Al before that, the man, Al means the man, okay. And Al will remove one Dhamma, so it becomes Al Insanu. Okay. When you read them together, it will become Al Insanu, the man. Okay. Now, this word Al Insanu is a noun. Al-insano is a noun. The word before that is a verb. Khalaqa, he created. So creator is here. But the one who is being created is here. Okay? So this is the doer. Doer is called fa'il. The one who does something. And the one that some work is being done on is maf'ul or subject. So when fa'il and maf'ul, verb and noun, they come together in the combination, one thing happens. What actually happens is that the word here is al-insanu. Al-insanu changes to al-insana. That's the rule that Dhamma changes into a fatha. By itself is al-insanu. But this word is coming as somebody is working on it. And when someone is working on it, it is a maf'ul. Work is being done. Okay? So always remember, and we'll see many other times here. This rule is a very standard. When you have a doer and you have a subject that somebody is working on, then the state changes from Dhamma to a Fatah, Al-Insana, Nasab. Rafa becomes Nasab.
How come then Khalaqa Samawati? Why it becomes?
Because Samawati is actually Samawata. Okay. In Arabic, plural has two states only, Samawatu, Samawati and Samawati. There is no fatha. Samawati comes in two states. When we come across that kind of word, I'll explain that in more details. But it is a state in Nasab. Okay, but Nasab actually there is a kasra, not a fatha. So khalaqal insana. He created the man. Okay, that's the word in the Quran. He created. Now who is he? He is again pointing to Rabb, the Lord who created the man. Okay? So this is created the man. Or he created the man. Okay? Now the next word is starts with these letters, Ain, Lam, and Qaf. Okay. Alaqa. The noun is Alaqun. Okay. Remember that all the nouns always end up with two dhammas, the sound of noon. Alaqun. Alaqun has multiple meanings, but the most meaning here is that the blood, when it becomes hard, is in the terminology called congealed blood. The blood which becomes hard. Okay? That is called the alakund. Okay? Alakund also has, in a biological term, is also has something. Basically, what it is that when the creation of the man starts, or the human being starts in the womb of the mother, the first formation is that it becomes, after the cells start dividing, it becomes a small clot of blood. Small blood. Reddish. Congealed means like a frozen. That is the very first stage of the creation inside the womb of the mother. And then this clot of blood starts building into a human shape. So that particular thing is called alakun. Okay? So that is what this word is, alakun. Okay?
And what does the verb mean? Alaka.
These are three root letters, and basically it means to hang something, or there are many meanings. Yeah. But alakun is especially used for the blood. Now this is a noun, so I don't know if you can create a verb out of this blood, you know. So alakun is the, okay? Now min is a harfijar. Min means from. And what harfijar does, it looks at these last letters, dhammas, and changes into kasras. Min alaqin, from the blood, from this congealed or hard blood, he created man. Okay? So from, and it is said congealed. G-E-A-L-E.
खून की फुटकी से
फटकी और
लोथड़ा कहते हैं
फटकी और लोथड़ा सेम थिंग अलाक बिकॉज एट द एंड ऑफ द आयत मिन अलाक फ्रॉम द congealed blood. He created man from that. That's the beginning of the creation in the womb of the mother. Okay. Then the next two words are same. Iqra, again, is a read or recite. Okay. And the word again nafsi wa means and, Rabboka means your Lord. Okay, you just saw these two words. And your Lord. Okay? And Kafra me. Karama. Karama means to honor someone. Okay? To honor. Now, if you have these words, for example, Hasin and Noon, Hasana means to be good, okay? If I put an Alif in the beginning, Ahsanun, this makes a superlative degree, better. Hasan means good, Ahsan means better. So in Arabic, you know, in English, we make comparative and superlative degrees. There are rules for that. Good, better, best. Okay. In Arabic, degree is made by putting an alif in the beginning. Ahsan means better. Hasan means good. Ahsan means better. Okay. So this Hasan and Ahsan. Hasanun or Ahsanun. So this means good. This means better. Okay. So here, if you look at that word, al-akramu, al is a separate word, al means the. And the word is akram, which is from ahsan, most honored, the most honored. Al-akramu means the most honored, the most generous. Okay? So that is the sifat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alladhi iqra, or recite, wa rabbuka, and your Lord is most honored, most generous, the greatest one. Okay? So that is the meaning of Al-akramu, the one who is very, very most honored. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sifat. Okay?
So what is ahsan, better or best?
In Arabic, there are in English, there are three stages. One is comparative, then third one is superlative. In Arabic, there are only two stages. Okay? How do you distinguish? If you are comparing with one person only in the context, then ahsan will be better. If the statement is about all the people, then it will be best. Okay? So there is only one way of making it. So al-akramu, because here it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you translate the most honored. Okay? If it was comparing two people, then you can say this is more honorable or more honored than this person. But if it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's the most honored. So, Al-Akramu, your Lord is the most honored. Okay? The most. Al means the. Okay? Most honored. Okay? And then the word after that in the next ayat is Al-Lazi, he again. So that is one, he created and he is the most honored, and he also did one more favor, which is the next one, which is Allama bil qalam. Okay, so let's look at these words. Ain, lam, and mim. Alama. Alama means to know. Ilm or knowledge is alama. Ain, lam, and mim. These are three letters. So when we have three letters, we say they belong to the group of the words fa'ala. We make a bigger word by adding something, and this time we are going to add a middle letter, shadda, on the middle letter. Fa'ala. Add another ayin there, it becomes two ayins, and become fa'ala. So this will become allama. Middle letter, twice, shadda. The meaning of this is to learn or to teach. Okay. Allama means to teach. And from this is ta'aleem. Ta'aleem is the teaching. Or mu'allim is the teacher. Okay. So, difference between alama and allama is, Allama means to learn something, to know something. Allama means to teach something. Okay? And when we put the three fathas on this one, becomes Allama. Allama means he taught. Okay? Here he is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allama. He taught. Okay? So the word becomes he taught. The third person past tense by putting three fathas. The next word is starts with these three letters: qaf, lam, and mim. And qalamun means pen. Qalamun means pen. Okay? And you put the al before that. Al means the pen. Okay? And when you put al, two dhammas change into one, it becomes al-qalamu. Al-qalamu means the pen. Okay? Now put a b before that. B means with. And B is a preposition, is a harfajar. What harfajar does, it looks at the next noun. Last letter, dhamma, changes into a kasra. It becomes al-qalami instead of al-qalamu because of the B. With the pen. Okay? And when you pronounce, you do not pronounce this alif. Pronounce bil qalami, and when you don't pronounce, then this changes into a small swar called hamzatul wasl. Bil qalami, with the pen. He taught with the pen. Okay. He taught knowledge to human being, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the pen to teach the knowledge, so they can communicate to each other through writing. Bil qalami, with the pen.
The word al-lazi, is that for emphasis or is it?
Which one?
Before
this one? Al-lazi, yeah. He is the one who, so again, you can do the same thing. You can write down, he is the one who taught. Okay, so this one you can write down who in place of he. Okay, or he taught. So, okay. So he taught with the pen. Okay, then the words are repeating here a lot. Then again the word allama comes, he taught. And again notice that actual word is al-insanu. Word start with insanun, we put al, it becomes al-insanu. Al-insanu is a noun and it is coming after the verb allama. So the rule is that insanu will change to insana. Just like khalaqa was a verb, allama is a verb. Al-insanu became al-insana because of the verb. Same thing will happen here. Al-insano became al-insana. Allamal insana. He taught man. Okay? He taught man. Okay? Or the man. Okay? So he taught the man. Okay, now let's look at the next three words. Okay, so the, going back, and lam mim, alama, we just saw that means to know. Okay. Also, if we have these three letters, fa'ala is to do. Okay. And if we put a ya in the beginning with a fataha and pronounce yaf'alu, this is the grammar of he does. Present tense, third person. Ya is the present tense. Third person. Yaf'alu. Okay. So if I apply that on these three letters, it will become ya'alamu. Ya'alamu. Okay. Just put a ya in the beginning. Keep the same arab. Ya'alamu means he knows. Okay, that's one word. Then the word ma means that which. Ma means that which or whatever. Ma, okay. Now after that there is this word lam. Okay, so lam with the alif, lam is not, and lam with the meem lam also means not. Okay, but there is a difference. Okay, and we'll see that difference here. Okay, the La is simple. Whenever you want to say negation of something, use the word la. Okay? But lam is a more powerful word. It does few things. So let's see what it does. Lam. Okay? First thing is meaning is not. Simple meaning is not. Okay? But whenever lam is used, it, now also notice that ya'alamu means present tense. He knows is in English is present tense. In Arabic is word ya'alamu is a present tense word. Okay, so it does two things. Okay, when lam comes before a present tense like this, first thing it does, it looks at the last letter here and changes into a sukoon. That's the first thing. Whenever you will see lam, there will be a present tense after that. The last letter dhamma will change into sukoon. So the pronunciation will become la ya'alam. Okay. The second thing, which is more important, it does, it pulls into the past tense. It pulls the meaning into the past tense. So the meaning will be he knew. Not he knows anymore. He knew. So the meaning becomes new. Okay? So proper English will be that which he did not know. If you combine these, not new is actually did not know. So ma'alam ya'alam, all three of them together will be translated that which he did not know. Allama al-insana, he taught man that which man did not know. The man did not know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught him. Okay, so that's the meaning of Allam al insana ma'alam ya'alam. Okay, ma means that which.
Is that a huruf jar?
Which one is a huruf jar?
Ma.
No, ma is not a huruf jar. That which he did not know. Okay, so this is another favor Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did, that he taught him with the pen, and then he also taught him everything. When we are born, we don't know anything. Or when the mankind was created, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided to give him knowledge. Okay, so to mankind, other creations are there, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not given that kind of knowledge. That has been given to mankind, okay, which he did not know. Okay, then the word kalla. Kalla is simply said no, or nay. Okay, that in English, if you are talking to someone and you want to emphasize on your given conversation, say nay, no, hold on, I want to tell you something. Okay, that's the meaning of kalla. Okay, there is no word, this is just a one full word. Okay, so the meaning is nay. Okay, then after that are two words. Okay, one is inna. Inna has meaning of sure or indeed. Sure, surely, or indeed. Okay, which means what is being said now is a definite statement. There's no doubt in that statement which is being mentioned now after the word inna. So inna, like in English, you start the sentence indeed, or definitely, or surely. No, okay. Now, if you notice one thing, inna does something also. In Arabic, a lot of words have effect on the next word. Okay, the actual word is Allahu. Okay, think of the word Allahu. When you recite or read the ayat, Inna Allaha ala kulli shayin qadeer, very commonly. So what happened? Inna made it Allaha. Actual word was Allahu, but in the ayat it says Inna Allaha. So what Inna does? It looks at the next word and changes the last letter Dhamma to a Fatah. So the word was Al Insanu. Okay? It became Al Insana because of the Inna. So the meaning is that nay, surely, the man. Now, let's look at the next word. La is one word and yatgha is the other word. This word is made of two parts, la yatgha. La has total separate meaning. Okay? La with a fatah is called lam-e taqeed. Lam-e taqeed means whenever this lam comes with a fatah, it emphasizes the statement. Basically, it brings the same meaning, surely, definitely. Okay. So, la means again, surely. Okay. So, in one statement, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the surely, definitely twice. One with inna, and second time with the la. So twice a statement is being stated by emphasis. Okay, la. Now this word ta, ghain and ya. Okay, this means to transgress. Okay, transgress like sarkashi. Go beyond the bounds, go beyond the limits. That's the word transgression. The one who transgresses, it means he crosses his boundaries. Sarkash. Okay.
Yes, Farsi. Yes, sin. Okay.
So that is the meaning of taqa. Okay. Okay. If you know the word tughyan, okay? Yes. Tughyan is when the water crosses the bank of the river, overflows, and when it crosses the limits, it becomes harmful instead of beneficial. Because when the tughyan comes in the river, the water, because of the flood, goes over the banks, and whatever comes in the path, it hurts, drowns, kills the crops. Okay, damages the things, drowns the people. So the same water which was beneficial, once it crosses its boundaries, it becomes harmful. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using that word for insan. Okay, so fa'ala again going back to that, Yaf'alu, he does. We just looked at this word. Yaf'alu. He and present tense does. Okay? So apply that here on these three letters. Okay? So what you do, you put a ya in the beginning with a fatha just like there. Then you take the three letters, ta, ghain, and ya, and you put the same ara. This has a sukoon, this has a fatha, this has a dhamma. Okay? The meaning will be, he transgresses. Present tense. He crosses the limits. He crosses the bounds. Yat rayu, like yaf alu. Okay. Now, this ya with the dhamma is a mismatch. Okay. So the sound of this dhamma is not pronounced. So pronunciation will become yat ga. Ya is written. So this will become yat ga, like that. Yat, this little alif is the sound of this ghain. It's called alif maqsura, short alif. It's not pronounced long, yat ga. Except that we are not pronouncing this last dhamma because it's a mismatch with the ya. The sound of ya is e. It has a dhamma sound of u. They don't go together. So we don't pronounce that. Pronounce yataba. It's easy on the tongue.
Can you explain the mismatch, please?
Okay, so there are three letters. Alif, ya, and waw, right? The sound of the alif is fatha, the sound of the ya is kasra, the sound of wa is dhamma. Okay? So that's the way the pronunciation goes. If alif is there and fatha is there, it's the same sound. This is mismatch here. Okay? Because this ya has the sound of e, but it has an u on it. Okay? So this is mismatch. Okay? So in order to make it, it's very hard to pronounce. Try to pronounce yat ghayu. Okay? So what we do, because ya is a weak letter and it has a mismatch, we adjust the sound to make it easy on the tongue, yat gha. We don't pronounce this dhamma sound, so rest of the word become yat gha. Okay? He transgresses. Definitely. La means surely. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that the mankind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him all these things, but he is rebellious. He transgresses. Surely he transgresses. Okay? Now, what he also does, Ar-ra'ahu staghna. Okay. So ra and alif and hamza. Ra, hamza and alif. Either way you can write down. Ra means to see. Araita lazi, raita ra means to see. And when we put three fathas like that, it becomes he did or he saw. When you put three fathas on fa'ala, it becomes the past tense. So Ra'ah means he saw. An means that. So that he saw. That he saw. Okay. And who means him. He saw him. And him means himself. So he sees himself. The mankind looks at him and he sees something. He saw himself. Okay, so this means himself. Who means self or he himself? He saw himself. That's the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning. After that he transgresses, he crosses the boundaries and the limits of everything. And then what else he does? He sees himself something. He finds something in himself. So that is Ar-Ra'ahu, that he saw himself. What did he see himself? Astaghna. Okay, the actual word is Astaghna. Let me explain that to you. So the root letters are Ghain, Noon and Ya. Okay? This means to be rich. Ghani is a rich person. Okay? Ghana, Ghani is rich person. So this is the root letters. Okay? Now, if I put three letters in the beginning of this, Alif, Sin and Ta. Ista. Okay? And keep these three letters, Ghain, Noon and Ya. Okay, it becomes istaghna. When you pronounce this together, istaghna. What is the word ista is bringing the meaning? The meaning is becoming now to be self-sufficient. Okay, when a person becomes very rich, he has everything. So what he says, I don't need anybody. I'm self-sufficient. That's istaghna. So ghana means to become rich. But istaghna is that I have everything, I don't need anybody. Okay. So that's the word here. He sees himself, I got everything.
Can I apply to fa'ala,
istaf'ala?
Is there any word?
Yes, this is actually the best example is ghafara. Okay, ghafara means to forgive. Okay, ist, put the ist beginning. This is one of the bab number 10. When you put ist at the beginning, the meaning becomes istaghfara. Okay, what is istaghfara? Asking for forgiveness. Istaghfar, ghafara is the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He forgives. Istaghfara is the characteristic of human being. He asks for forgiveness. Okay? So istaghfar, when we say astaghfirullah, ist, we put ist in the beginning, it brings the meaning of asking there. Okay? Here, you can apply the similar meaning. Someone is rich, and someone is saying that, I have everything, I don't want anybody's help. Sufficient. To be sufficient completely. Okay? That's istaghna. Okay? And there are many other words. Istama, istamala, istamal, and many words which ista is beginning in the beginning.
Do you want to finish it or the time is up by now?
It's up to you.
So if we give 5 minutes or from break to you, and if you want to finish. Yeah, okay.
Okay. So istaghna, that's the word. He sees himself, he saw himself that he is self-sufficient. Which means he doesn't need, you know, any help, or he doesn't need anything from Allah because he has got everything. Okay, so that's the meaning of that he transgresses and he says, I got everything. Istaghna. Self-sufficient. Okay. Lot of repetition of the words. Okay. Inna, again, surely. And ila rabbika. Okay. So, inna means surely. And we know the word rabbun. Plus ka. And by the combination, it became rabbuka. Your Lord. Okay. Ila means to. Okay. Or toward. And ila is a harfajar. Harfajar will change the dhamma to a kasra. It has also happened there. So, ila rabbika means to your Lord. Indeed, surely to your Lord. To your Lord. Okay. And these three letters, Raja A, means to return. Okay. Very commonly we use this word when we say Inna ilaihi raji'un. Raji'un is Raja. We return to Allah. Raja'a means to return. And Ar-Raja'a means the returning. Ar-Raja'a or Raja'a means the returning. Okay? So indeed to your Lord is the returning. Just like Raji'un, we return to Allah. And here it says to your Lord is the return. Okay? So Allah is saying that, okay, you can be istaghna, you can be yatgha, but the end is that
you will
return. Okay? Is the return.
You won't go anywhere.
Yeah, you will not go anywhere. Okay? Now, ara'aita. We read, recite this surah about ara'aita al-lazi. Okay. Ra'a means to see. We just saw the word Ra'a means to see. Ara'aita means you saw. When you put a ta in the beginning, it brings the meaning of you. Okay, so ara'aita. Okay, here you saw. Okay, or did you see? Allazi means him or he. Yanha. Yanha, we'll just take this one, Noon, Ha, and Ya. Yanha means to forbid. To stop someone from doing something. Nahi, or Yanha, Naha, Yanha, to forbid. Nahi Anil Munkar, we use this word all the time. Amr bil Maruf, Nahi Anil Munkar. Nahi means to forbid. And ye, notice that there is a ya in the beginning. Ya brings the meaning of present tense. Yanha, he forbids. Okay? Araita lazi, you saw, or did you see him who forbids? Ya in the beginning. And we just learned from the word yatgha that yaf'alu, this will have a dhamma, but they'll come pronounced as in small alif. Yanha. Yatgha, yanha. Same rule. So, have you seen the person who forbids? Forbids what? Abdan idha salla. Okay? Abdan means slave. Abdun is slave. Abdun means slave. Abada means to be slave or to worship. Abdun means slave, okay? And Idah means when. So, did you see the one who forbids the slave when? Okay. And I'm just going quickly because these words are known. Swad, Lam, Ya means to worship or to pray. Okay. And Salla means he prayed. So what is happening that when Prophet is standing to pray, people are trying to stop him. In the very beginning, this is very, very beginning. And I believe that this whole surah was not revealed at the same time. Only few ayats of these surahs were revealed the very first time. And at that time, Prophet was not praying the way, you know, it is prayed now. So when the rest of the surah was revealed, he was praying in the Kaaba. And Mushrikeen were stopping him. What are you doing? Don't do this. Okay? So, Yanha, forbidding the slave of Allah, which is Abdun, but is coming after Yanha, when a verb and noun come together. Noun becomes two fathas. Okay? Ida Salla, when he prayed. Or when he stood up to pray. Okay? So the ayat, the surah continues, but there are a few other things after that. But for the slave, when he prayed, or you can say when he prays, okay? But actually, when he stood to pray, they stopped him. An ayat is coming, we translate when he prays. Okay? So this, there are about 9 more ayats of this surah with more details in them. Okay, but remember that this is the very first revelation of the Quran, and these things are being mentioned. Okay. So inshallah we'll stop. So we have... So inshallah we'll go and start the class. We have done a part of this surah last time, Surah Al-Alaq. And we'll try to finish today. Before we study remaining ayats here, let's spend a few minutes understanding the background of this surah, because that's very important to understand what's being said here. So this surah, Al-Alaq, has 19 ayats in it. The first 5 ayats were the first revelation of the Quran to Prophet ﷺ, the very first Quran, first revelation. The remaining ayats were revealed at some other time, some different time. And there is some gap in between these two. When the first 5 ayats were revealed, Prophet was in a cave, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the angel Jibreel alayhi salam came and gave him these 5 ayats. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Then some time passed, and Prophet has now become a prophet, and he is starting now praying. The prayer, the salat, has been made obligatory, and he is now praying in the Kaaba. So the Quraysh and the Kuffar don't like that he is praying in a Kaaba, inside the Kaaba, in the way they don't pray. He is standing and making sajda and ruku and all those things, and they don't like it. So Abu Jahl is the one who is very strong in opposing Prophet ﷺ. And so when he sees and he hears that Prophet ﷺ is praying inside the Kaaba, making sajda and praying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made some remarks. He said a few things about Prophet ﷺ, that if I see him doing this next time, I will put my foot on his neck when he's in a sajda and drag him and do something with Prophet Sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these ayahs mentions the details of that event. The name, typically in the Quran, Quran doesn't mention the names. But the person, the other person that is being talked in these ayat is Abu Jahl. And what he said and what he was done is being mentioned in these ayat. Okay? So with that background, we will try to understand what's being said here. Okay? So the last two ayats of the surah that we did last time, they were about the saying of Abu Jahl that he was trying to stop Prophet ﷺ when he was praying. That's where the ayat, last two ayats ended. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayat number 11 is talking about Prophet ﷺ. Okay, so let's understand that. The first word here is ara'aita. Okay, so the word ara'aita, as I'm trying to understand here, is ra, alif, and ya. Okay. These three letters means to see. Ra means to see. Okay. Now, from our template, if we have these three letters, fa, n, and lam, fa'ala means to do. Okay. And if I put a ta at the end, combine these three letters and put a ta at the end and pronounce as fa'alta. Fa'alta means you, third person and past tense. So the meaning of this is you did. Fa'alta means you did. So if you are talking to someone, one person, and you are talking about the past tense, you will say fa'alta, you did. Okay? So if we apply this rule on these three letters here and put a ta at the end of this thing, that's the only thing we're doing. We're putting a little ta here with a fatha. So if you put a ta here, the meaning will be you saw. Past tense. And the second person. So you saw. So this word will become ra ay ta. Fa'alta ra ay ta. The same sound, same harakat, same voice. Ra ay ta. Ra ay ta means you saw. Okay? Now this typically this alif is not written here. So this is ra aita. Ra aita means you saw. Now, in Arabic, if you put an alif in the beginning of this thing with a hamza and fatah, ah, this brings the meaning of a question mark in English. So the word now is araita. Ara'aita means, did you see? It becomes a question mark. You saw is ra'aita, and if you want to make the English question mark of this statement, it will be, did you see? That is equivalent to putting an alif in Arabic. So, ara'aita, just like the surah ara'aita al-lazi, that's the same word there also. So, word ara'aita means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, did you see or have you seen? Okay, so that is the meaning of araita. Did you see? Now the second word here is in. Okay. In means if. In is a conditional statement. It means if. So the meaning is, did you see if okay. Now let's look at the next word. The next word starts with these three letters, kaf, waw, noon. Okay? The English meaning of these three letters is to be. To be. Okay? Now again, going back to the grammar, if you have three letters, fa'ala, and you put one fataha on each of them, fa'ala, this is the grammar of third person past tense, he did. Okay. Fa'ala is the grammar of third person, he, and the past tense, fa'ala. So if you apply that grammar rule here, this will become kaf with the fataha, waw with the fataha, and noon with the fataha. Okay. It will be pronounced as kawana. The meaning will be, he was. The past tense of to be is was. Okay. He was. Okay. Now what happens is that waw here is a weak letter, and it has a fatah on it. So the sound of this becomes the sound of alif. So it becomes kana. Okay. And the fatah is not written here. So kana means he was. Okay. So the meaning will be, did you see if he was? Now, the word ala means upon or on. Ala means on or upon. The next word starts with these three letters, ha, dal, and ya. This means to guide. Hada means to guide. And the noun from this is hodan, which is written this way. Hodan means guidance. Hodan is a noun, is a word from these three letters, and the meaning of hodan is guidance. Okay. Now, if we put al before that, al means the. Al means the. Okay. And what al does is that al, when there are two harakats here, like tanween, it removes one of them. So two of these will go away and it will become only one. Okay. So the word will be written like that, al hu, and this is written this way. This fatha and ya together are written as al huda. Okay. Al huda means the guidance. Hudan means a guidance or guidance only, and al brings the concept of the. Al-Huda, the guidance. And when you combine this with Allah in the beginning, then you read Al-Huda, you do not recite the Alif in between. It will be Al-Huda, upon or on guide, on the guidance. Okay? So this will be on the guidance or upon the guidance. Okay. So what's being said here? Abu Jahl is opposing Prophet ﷺ. Okay, when he When he's praying in the Kaaba, he is posing it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing anybody and saying, did you see if he was, if the Prophet was on the guidance? Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling the reader or the listener or whoever is there who is noticing that Abu Jahl is stopping Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah says that, did you see that this Prophet was actually a guided Prophet? He's not doing on his own, but he's doing this action because he is on a guidance. He's been guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the statement in a question mark statement. Okay? Did you see if he was on the guidance? If he is on the right path and you are opposing him, so what will happen to you? Okay? So in the narration, in the ahadith, it is mentioned that one day Abu Jahl saw Prophet ﷺ making sajda, praying. And he had said that if I see him next time, I'm going to step my foot on his neck. So he went to Prophet ﷺ with the intention of doing what he has said. And then when he reached close to him, he turned back and walked away. So people said, what happened? Okay. He said, I saw a fire between me and him. Abu Jahl said that between me and Prophet, I saw a fire. And I went back. Okay. So Prophet ﷺ heard and he said that if he had walked closer, he would have been punished or burned. Okay. So that is what the story is. Now, so let's go to the next ayah. So next ayat, again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying something about Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? So let's look at that one. The first word, aw, aw means or. Okay? So aw means or. Okay? Then the next word is from these three letters, Alif, Meem, and Ra. Amara. Amara means to command. Okay. Amara means to command. Okay. Apply the same rule here, this grammar rule, on these three letters. It means put a fataha on each of them. So this will become Amara. Okay? And the meaning will be he and the past tense. So here the meaning will be he commanded. Okay? He commanded. So, aw amara, or he commanded. Okay, so let's look at the next word. The next word starts with these three letters, Waw, Qaf, and Ya. Okay? And one of the meaning is to save. Okay. In the dua we say, Waqina Adhab An-Nar. Okay? We make dua, save us from the fire of hell. So Waqa means to save. From this word is the word taqwa. Taqwa. Taqwa means, there are many meanings of taqwa. Generally people know this because it's very much used in the speeches and in the khutbahs and all. Taqwa means to be right, to have righteousness. or to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So taqwa has meaning of have a fear or to be righteous. Okay, so taqwa means righteous. Righteousness actually. Okay. Which means someone has taqwa means he is on the right path. That's the meaning of taqwa. Okay. Now, put al before that. Al means the. And when you recite these together, the lam is not recited because ta feels the sound of lam. So it is recited at taqwa. At taqwa. Lam is not pronounced, but ta is pronounced twice because ta is a shamsi letter, gives the sound of lam. So the pronunciation will be at taqwa. The righteousness. Okay? So now, one more thing, B, okay. B means with or on or off, there are many meanings, okay. So now you recite, lam was not pronounced, so it becomes bit taqwa, that's the word in the Quran. Bit taqwa means on the right, or of the righteousness, or with the righteousness, or on the right path. Okay? So, aao hamara bit taqwa, or he commands of the right righteousness. So, Prophet ﷺ is commanding to be on the right path. So what is the wrong he is doing if he is inviting people and in commanding them to be the righteous people, then that is what he is doing. He is praying and he is inviting. So did you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you read the ayat together, did you see if he was on the guidance and he was commanding for the righteousness? So that is what is Prophet ﷺ is doing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inviting others to think that why he is being opposed. All he is doing that he is on the right path, guidance, huda, and he is demanding for the righteousness. Okay, so that is the meaning so far. Bit taqwa of righteousness, of the. So those two ayats are about Prophet ﷺ. Okay. Now, in the next ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is inviting the person who is watching this or listening or in the audience to look at Abu Jahl now. Okay. These two ayats were, look at Prophet, what he's doing. Okay. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next ayah says, okay, now look at the person who is opposing him. Okay, so let's understand those. The first word is same, ara'aita. Okay, did you see? Okay, so it is, address is to the people here. Okay, the one who is reading the ayah, reading the Quran, or is watching this whole thing going on, third person. Okay, ara'aita, did you see? Okay. Again, the next word is same. In means if. Araita, did you see if? Okay. So now let's look at the next words. So the next word starts with these three letters: kaf, dal, and pa. Kadaba. The meaning of this word is to lie. someone is nine, that's kadaba. Okay, these are three letters. So whenever we have three letters, we say they belong to the group of the words we call fa'ala. Just like that. You see? Now we make bigger words by adding something else in the three letters. And in this case, we will just add a shadda on the middle letter. Which means middle letter is pronounced twice now. Okay, so the word, the name is now fa'ala. Okay, so what will happen to this? You put the middle letter with the shadda on it, so it become kadaba. This is kadaba, za pronounced once only. This middle letter is pronounced twice, so it is pronunciation kadaba. This has a different meaning. Kadaba means to deny. So what's the difference between a lie and denying? Kadaba and kadaba. Someone is not telling you the truth. He's lying. Okay. If someone is not telling the truth, he is lying. Okay? But if you are saying something and the other person says no, you're wrong. He's denying. That's the difference between lying and denying. In lying, one person is involved. He is lying. He is not telling the truth. But in denying, there are two people there, or more than two people. Because one is saying something, other is rejecting that, denying that. Okay? So that is the difference in the meaning in kadaba and kadaba. In Arabic language, you make bigger words from the same words and the meanings keep changing. In English, you notice that there is no relationship between L-I-E and D-E-N-Y. Totally different words. But in Arabic, just put a shadda on the middle letter, it brings a different meaning. And they are related because lying and denying has to go hand in hand. Okay. So, kadaba means to deny. Okay. Now, apply this rule of grammar that put a fataha on each of them. So, this will become kadaba. Kadaba. Okay. And what happens when you put one fataha on each of them? It becomes third person, person and the past tense. So the meaning of kadaba will be he denied. Okay, third person, he, past tense is denied. Okay. So that's the meaning of kadaba.
Still remains a singular?
Yeah, third person, singular. Yeah. What, if you make the plural, then we add a vowel at the end. So it becomes fa'alu, this will become kadabu. Okay? Kadabu will be they denied. Okay? So you always start with the simplest grammar, which is he, and then you add plural in there. Okay? So kadaba, he denied. Okay? So the meaning is ara'aita, did you see? In if kadaba, he denied. He is who is he here? Abu Jahl. Did you see that he denied? Okay. First two ayats about, okay, look at the Prophet. What is he doing? He is on the guidance and he is commanding the taqwa. Then Allah says, now look at the other person who is Abu Jahl. And what is he doing? First thing he is doing is kadaba. He is denying, which means whatever Prophet is saying, this person is rejecting that, is denying that. Okay, so that is the meaning of kadaba, he denied. Okay. Now let's look at the next word. The The one word in between is a waw with a fatha, that means end. So wa means end. Now let's look at the next word, tawalla. Okay. So this word, this starts with these three letters, waw, lam, and ya. Okay. The meaning of these three letters is to come close. Wala means to come close. The word wali that we use, wali means a friend. From the same letters, wali is someone who is close to you, he's your friend. Okay, so wala means waw, lam, and ya means to come close. Okay, that's the meaning of these three letters. And because these are three letters, they belong to the group we call fa'ala. Okay. Now we are going to make a bigger word. Okay? And this time we are going to make a bigger word in Arabic, and there's a rule for that we add a ta in the beginning. Okay? And we put the same three letters, fa'ala, but add a shadda on the middle letter. So in the, remember last time we just added a shadda, kazzaba became kazzaba. That was one rule of making a bigger letter, bigger word. Another rule, there are 10 rules altogether in Arabic, they're called 10 babs. How to make bigger words from three fundamental letters. So this is one of the rules, is that you put a shadda on the middle one and you put a ta in the beginning. So the sound of this becomes tafa'ala. Ta fa ala. Okay? So this will become ta walla. Okay? So you put a ta in the beginning. Okay? And you put these three letters, waw, lam, ya. But on the middle letter, you put a shadda. You put a shadda on the middle letter. So this word becomes tawalla. Tawalla means to turn away. Okay? So the meaning of this is to turn away. Now notice, you know, the beauty of the language. The first word was come close. Okay? This is just the opposite of that. Turn away. Okay? You come close to someone, you become friend. You turn away from the person, you become the enemy. Okay? So that's the meaning of tawalla. Okay? Now apply this rule. Put a fatha on each of them. Okay? What does that do? It brings the third person and the past tense. Okay? So this will become tawalla. Written this way, tawalla. Tawalla means he, third person, and the past tense is turned away. So that is the second thing Abu Jahl did. First thing, kazzaba. He denied the Prophet. And then what he did? He turned away. He just went away from the Prophet. Okay. So that is what? Ara'aita, did you see? Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making you a witness there. Okay? If you were there standing, you would see that Prophet is on the guidance and he is commanding for the taqwa. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, now look at the other person. What is he doing? He has denied the Prophet and then he turned away, went home. Okay? So that is, he turned away, watawalla, and he turned away. So that is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is presenting a scene or a scenario there that is taking place. Now, in the next ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a very different thing. Okay. What is Allah saying in the next ayat? That, don't you know that Allah is watching all this? Allah is seeing all this. Allah is seeing him, what is he doing? Okay. So let's look at the next ayat.
Question also. Here, is it literally that he denied, he came closer to do something and turned away?
Yeah. This is a hadith. There are many hadiths about this one. That he came close and he himself admitted that he went back for that reason. And later on, someone mentioned to Prophet Sallam, and Prophet Sallam said, yes, if he had gotten close to me, he would have been burned. Allah's azab would have. And you will see that in next few ayahs, there is a more description about the incident. Okay? So let's look at the next ayah. Alam ya'alam bi anna allaha yara. Okay, so let's look at these words. Okay? So the first, this is alif. Then there is the next word is lam. Okay. Now, we saw this alif. Alif brings the question mark. Okay. Ra'aita, we saw in that one. Ra'aita means you saw. Ra'aita, did you see? So, alif in the beginning is bringing the question mark. Okay. So, now, lam. Lam means not. Okay? But we will see a little bit more details what lam also does. Just not a simple not, but it does few other things. So we'll see that. Okay? Now, let's look at the word en lam mi. Okay. Alama. Alama means to know. Alama is to know. Ilm and knowledge, alim, all those words are commonly known. Alama means to know something. Okay? Now, going back to the basic rules of the grammar, fa'ala means to do. If I put a ya in the beginning and pronounce it ya'alamu or yaf'alu, yaf'alu. Yaf'alu, ya is the beginning, brings the meaning of present tense. Okay? Before we saw the past tense, now it is present tense. So the meaning of this word is he does. Third person, but the present tense. So how you make the past tense and present tense? In past tense, you put three fathas, fa'ala. In the present tense, yaf'alu, he does. Okay? So you apply that rule here. This will become ya'alamu. Ya'alamu. Okay. So the meaning is, he knows. Okay. Now, lam. So la means not, and lam also means not. But lam does few other things. La, simple lam is not. Lam does few other things. Okay, first thing what lam does, when a verb comes after that, ya alamu, it does two things to that. Okay, first thing it does, it changes this last letter dhamma into a sukoon or jazm. Okay, that's the effect of lam. So the word becomes ya alam instead of ya alamu, it becomes ya lam. The second thing it does, it moves the word into the past tense. The meaning goes into the past tense. Okay? So alam ya alam means, did he not know? If you make a sentence here, alif is bringing the question mark, and rest of the statement is negative statement of the past tense. So in English, how will you translate? Did he not know? Okay. Did he, did I, because past tense and question mark and not. If you combine all these, the sentence, correct sentence in English will be, did he not know? Okay, so that is the meaning of alam ya alam, did he not know? Did he not know? Now who is he here? He is Abu Jahl. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to the one who is reading or listening that, did he not know? Means, did Abu Jahl not know? Not know about something. Okay? So that is alam ya alam. Alam ya alam means, did he not know? So now we have next three words, B, Anna, and Allahu. These are the original letters. Okay. So, Anna, Anna has two meanings. Anna means that, or Anna means surely. Okay. So I'm going to write down both the meanings here. Anna means that, and surely. And both meanings can be put here, and either will work. Okay. B means of, or with, or in. There are many meanings of B. Okay. Now, the word Anna or Inna, Inna also means surely. When a noun comes after that, then it makes one change in the noun. It looks at the last letter and changes into fatha. So instead of annallahu, it became annallah. This is very commonly ayat is recited. Inna allaha ala kulli shayin qadir. Inna allaha. Inna changes allahu to allaha. Okay. So bi anna allah, that Allah. Okay. And in this case, even if you don't translate in English, B, the meaning will be, did he not know that Allah? Or about that Allah, or of that Allah. Okay. So here will be that Allah. Now let's look at the next word, is going back to these three letters, Ra, Alif, and Ya, that the first letter, first word, Ra'aita, we started with this. This means to see. Okay. Now, let's look at this rule. You put a ya in the beginning, it brings the meaning of he, third person, and present tense. Okay. Apply that rule here. Okay. So this will become ya in the beginning with a fataha, and the next three letters are ra, alif, and ya. Okay. And you put this same harakats here. So first letter has sukoon, second add this, and this one is the dhamma. Okay. We just take the rule exactly, the template, and apply it on these three letters. So by however it is pronounced, that's a separate thing. But the meaning will be he and the present tense. So the meaning will be he sees. He sees. Okay. Or present tense, you can say he is seen. Both are correct in present tense. Okay. Now this word is hard to pronounce. Yar, au, you. Okay? So people make it easy to pronounce that. Okay? So the first thing that we should notice is that, and we have been coming across, ya has a dhamma on it. This is a mismatch. Ya is a weak letter. It can easily be changed like vowels in English. Okay? So what happens is that, in this case, ya is there and ra. So what we did, we got rid of this dhammas here and this sound also. And this sukoon we changed with this alif. So it's become easy to pronounce ya ra. If you try to pronounce, it will be very hard to pronounce this one. Yar, ayu. Okay. So, because there are weak letters in between, in when weak letters are three weak letters. Alif, Vav, and Ya. Whenever they come in the word, you are allowed to change the sound and harakats on them. To make easy on the tongue to pronounce. Just like in English vowels, we do the same thing. Okay. So, like neighbor, sometimes it is written with N-E-I-G-H, okay? We don't pronounce many of those letters in the neighbor, okay? Why? Just to make it easy on that, okay? So, yara means he is seeing. Who is here he? The word before that is Allah. So, you don't have to translate he because the noun is already there. So the meaning will be Allah is seen or Allah sees. Don't you know or did you not know that Allah is seeing all this, what going on there? Okay. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that fact that Allah is seeing. Okay. What Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is doing and what Abu Jahl is doing, Allah is witnessing all that thing. Allah is seeing all that thing. So let's look at the next ayat. Okay. Kalla. Kalla is had come a few times. Kalla means nay. Okay. In Urdu say hargiz nahi. Never it can happen. Okay. No. Stop it now. That's the meaning of ne or kalla. Okay. If someone is saying something to you, say, no, hold on. No, this is not the way it is. That's the way it is. So that's ne kalla. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word kalla. Now let's look at this letter along with the fatha. And there is another, will come in this one, we'll just mention noon with the shadda. These two are very special characters with special meanings. Both of them means surely. Okay. Indeed, surely, certainly, without any doubt, all those meanings are. Okay. This is called Lam-e-Taukeed. Lam is the letter. Taukeed means to emphasize about something. When you want to say you want to emphasize about something, you use the word Lam, the letter Lam. And Taukeed means emphasis. The word Taukeed by itself means emphasizes, emphasis something. Okay. This similarly, this is called Noon Taukeed. How are they used? If Lam comes in the beginning of a word, that means that word which is being said is a heavy word, it's being emphasized. Certainly, it is going to be that. But sometimes Lam and Noon come together. Lam comes in the beginning of the word, Noon comes at the end of the word. That means you are making a statement or you're saying one word and you are surrounding that word by two sureties. So that means that word has a lot of weight. Because you're saying surely this is going, if I say surely this is a pen, surely. Which means I'm in the beginning I'm saying surely, at the end I'm saying surely. Which means there is no doubt that this is something but a pen. Okay? So that is the purpose of Lam Taukeed and Noon Taukeed. Okay? So now keeping these two, first word is Lam Taukeed plus In. Okay? This is written as La In. Okay? And we saw that in means if. Okay? So this becomes surely if. Surely if. La in means, that's the word here. La in means surely if. Surely if. Okay, then let's look at these three letters, Noon, Ha and Ya. Okay, this means to forbid. Forbid means telling someone to stop doing something. Okay. For example, Amr bil Maruf or Nahi anil Munkar. Nahi means telling someone to stop doing wrong thing. So Nahi means that, forbidding someone from doing something. Nahi. These are three letters. So they belong to the group of the words called Fa'ala. Okay. Now we are going to make a bigger word. And one way of making it another bigger word is we put an alif in the beginning and a ta. Okay. So this word becomes, we put alif first and then after the first letter we put a ta. And then we have an and lam. So fa'ala becomes if ta'ala. It pronounced with if. This is alif and kasra. If ta'ala. So this word becomes alif with kasra and ta and noon, ha and ya. So we made a bigger word, but this is the rule of adding a alif and a ta, two letters. So intaha. What's the meaning of intaha? Means to stop or to desist. Okay. Intaha. Naha means to stop someone from doing wrong. And intaha means you stop doing it wrong. Baz aa jao. Okay, stop doing it. Okay, that's intaha.
Does it mean you reach your limits, like it's, you're going about to go beyond limits?
That is also meaning of intaha in one of the words in Urdu and Farsi. Intaha means the limit of something. So you can actually derive that meaning from here. You have reached the limit. You better stop now. Okay? Desist now. Stop it. Okay? So that is the meaning of intaha. Okay? Now also notice that there is a lam from before that. And lams make this negative. Okay? Number one. Number two, and I'm now giving you the idea that how by similarities you can start driving the meaning. Okay? There is a ya in the beginning. Okay? Ya brings the meaning of third person and present tense. And lam brings the meaning of not. Okay? So if you look at the word here, lam is there and then ya is in the beginning. Okay, and the word is from intaha, yan tahi. Okay, the meaning is that if he does not stop, he stop, lam will make it, he does not stop. So Allah is saying that surely if he does not stop, was he doing? Abu Jahl, he is constantly opposing the Prophet sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving him a warning, saying, surely if he does not desist, if he does not stop, what he is doing is constantly trying to stop Prophet ﷺ from praying inside the Kaaba. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after making those statements, is issuing a warning to this person by saying, nay, surely, if he does not stop. Okay? One more thing. I mentioned that lam puts the meaning in the past tense. So the meaning will be if he did not stop. If he did not stop. What he is doing if he did not stop. Okay? So the meaning will be lam yantahi if he did not stop. He did not stop. Okay. Now, two more words. So one word starts with these letters, seen, fa, and Ayn. Okay. This means to drag or to pull. Safa, seen, fa, and Ayn means to drag or to pull someone. Okay. Okay. Now, let's look one more rule here. if I put a noun instead of a ya, and keep the same word, naf'alu, instead of yaf'alu, noon brings the meaning of we do. Ya brings the meaning of he, present tense. Noon brings the meaning of we, present tense. Naf'alu, we do. Also, in Arabic, the present tense and future tense have the same grammar. Okay? So this also means we will do. We will do it. So apply that rule here. Put a noon in the beginning with a fatha. Nasfa'u. Nasfa'u. Just put a noon in the beginning and pronounce the same way. Naf'alu nasfa'u. Meaning will be, we will drag, we will pull. So this is, we will drag, or we will pull. Now here, we is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that, if he does not stop, kalla la illam yantahi, if he does not stop, what are we going to do? We are going to drag. Okay? We are going to pull. Okay? Now, this is nasfa'u. Okay? Now, we just learned one more thing. That if you put a lam, a ta'kid in the beginning, and a noon, a ta'kid at the end. Okay? This means surely. And this means surely. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, surely we will drag him, surely. Two emphasizes, double taqeed. No doubt. First of all, who is the speaker here? The speaker is Allah himself. So there should not be any doubt that he will just say something. Not do it. Not only that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is adding two more letters. A lam in the beginning and a noon at the end. And both of these are emphasizing. Okay? So the meaning will be definitely, 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 surely, surely, we will drag. We will drag this person where the next word is bin nasiya, is in the hellfire. Okay.
So where is the noon at the end?
This one?
Yes.
This noon with the shadda is being added.
Yeah, but where is it?
Oh, we'll come to that. This little meme there, this is ba after that. Whenever you have a ba and noon together in the recitation, you have a noon there. Okay? If noon and ba come together, then the sound of noon changes into the sound of meme. Okay? Sound of noon, and we pronounce that. For example, this is minbar. In writing, it is written minbar. This is the pulpit. How do we pronounce minbar? We pronounce noon as a meme. Minbar. Why we do that? Because in the tajweed, when the noon and ba come together next to each other like this, okay? Then ba gives the sound of noon, makes the sound of Meem. That's the Tajweed. That is the reason. This Ba here, little Ba, there was a sound of Noon. It changed the sound of Meem. So this sound of Noon became sound of Meem. Okay? So, La Nasfi Al, there are a couple other things happen there. Whenever this Noon Taqeed comes, then last letter of this changes into a Fatha. So it becomes La Nasfa An. But B, Ba will change La Nasfa Am, sound of Meem. So if you're reading this ayat, you'll be pronouncing La Nasfa Am Bis Bin Nasriya, not La Nasfa An. Actually, the word is An here. But in the Tajweed, and to satisfy the Tajweed, instead of writing a Noon there, we write a Meem there. So you can read correctly. But the word is being created this way. We will definitely drag this person, him. Okay? So the meaning is, La Nas Fa'am, we will surely, and surely is twice here, surely drag him. Okay? So, going back to this ayat, we learned up to this point, Kalla la illam yantahi la nasfan. And the meaning was that, nay, surely, if he is your Abu Jahl, he did not stop what he is doing with Prophet ﷺ, then we will definitely, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we will drag him. Okay? So the next word here, I want to go back on that one, is it starts with these letters, Noon, Saad, and Waw. And the word that is created, the noun from this is Nasiyatun. Nasiyatun actually means the front of the head, the forelock. The forehead or forelock. Okay? So this one is Peshani. So this is Nasiyatun. Now you put Al before that. Al means Da. And Al will remove one Dhamma from here. So it becomes Al Nasiyatu. And in the pronunciation, it will be An Nasiyatu. And then you add a B. B has many meanings, but the best one here is Bai. So B is a harfajar. Harfajar looks at the next noun and changes this Dhamma to a Kasra. So the final pronunciation will be Binnasiyati. Binnasiyati means by the forelock. By the forehead. So what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that we are going to pull him or drag him by holding his front part of the head. Okay, forelock, Peshani. So this is what the punishment is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he says that if he does not stop, Abu Jahl does not stop, that we are going to drag him by his forehead or forelock. Okay. So this is what it is. Peshani.
And what does the verb means Nasfi here?
Sometimes there may not be any meaning, but it means pulling something. Yeah. Usually in the Quran, if it is not used, just one noun is used, then it's very simple. Okay. So now after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the next ayat mentions three things. Nasiyatin, Kadibatin, Khatiyatin. Okay? So let's look at, first word is, we know, just we learned that, Nasiyatun. The original word is Nasiyatun. We just learned that. Okay? B was the harfajar that had made it Nasiyati. But that is because of the combination of other words. By itself, the original word is nasiyatun, because all the nouns end up with two dhammas here, the sound of noon. Nasiyatun. This means forehead or forelock. That's one word. Okay. The second word is from kaf, dal, and ba. We saw this means to lie. Okay. A person who lies is kazibatun, a liar, which is written this way, or it is also written this way. Same thing. Kazibatun. Okay. You can write down this alif as a long alif with kaf, or you can write down this short alif. Meaning is same. Kazibatun means liar. Someone who lies is kazibatun. Okay? Then the third word here is kha, ta, and alif. Okay? Khata. This means to commit a sin, to do a sin. And the noun from this is khatiyatun. Khatiyatun means sinful. A person who does sin. A sinful person. Khatiyatun. As I said, all the nouns always end up with two dhammas. So the original word is nasiyatun. The second word is kadibatun. The forelock, the liar. And khatiyatun, the sinful. Okay? So three things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning about the four head of four lock, a liar, and a sinful. Okay? Now, all these three words are coming after this word, bin nasiyati. Okay? Bin nasiyati, this is where it starts, and then three words are being mentioned after that. Now, this word bin nasiyati, by the forelock, okay, is a noun. Okay, and these three words are coming as the sifat or adjective of that noun. Adjective is that you are defining the quality of a person. For example, if you say a boy, you're just talking about a boy. But if you say a good boy, that is the sifat of that child. Okay? So sifat. In Arabic, when the sifat or adjective is mentioned, it has to follow certain rules. And one of the most basic rules is that however the noun is pronounced, sifat is pronounced the same way. So originally, if I had taken out al from there, this word was nasiyatin. Nasiyatin. So because this is second time, the same word is being mentioned, it has to come with the same pronunciation, nasiyatin. Now, the sifat of this forehead is that it is a lying forehead. So kazibatun has to become kazibatin, because they have to follow the same rhythm. Khatiatun has to be pronounced as khatiatin. Okay? Now, notice that most of the arrogance starts in the head. Most of the denial starts from the head. This is the front part of the head, that is the brain is behind it, that is what does everything wrong. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pointing to that part of the body which is committing all these things. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this person Abu Jahl, because his head is so arrogant that he is constantly opposing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, even though he knows that prophet is not doing anything wrong. He is opposing the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So what we will do as a punishment, we will grab him by his forelock. Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says that we will catch him, we will hold him by his front of his head like this, and then we will drag him. Okay? It's a very insulting way. Okay? Then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, why with the forehead? Why with the forelock? Because that is where he is lying from. That's where his all his lies originate from. Come from there. So that is the source of his lying and arrogance. Not only that, that is where all the sins are being committed from. Khatiyatun is sinful. So this particular place in our body, in the front of the head, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, is the source of lying, is the source of denying, is the source of committing all the sins. So, better fix this thing. Okay? So that is, these three words are the sifat, the adjective, the quality of this head that is making a person denying and opposing the Prophet ﷺ. Okay, so there is three different things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about this head. Okay. So this is forehead, repeating one more times, and it is a liar. And this is a sinful. Okay. Then let's look at the next word. فَلْيَدْعُوا نَادِيَا. Okay. The word starts with dal and waw. Okay. Da'aw means to call. Like dua is from the same word. Dua is a call. Okay. So da'aw, dal, ayn, waw means to call someone. To invite someone. Da'awat is the invitation, is a call. Okay? So da'aw means to call. Okay? Now, let's look at this word. You put a ya in the beginning, it becomes third person and present tense. Yaf'alu. So if I apply that rule here and put a ya in the beginning, and put the same harakats, okay? So this will become yad-u. Let's first follow exactly the same harakat. Ya has a fata, second letter has a sukoon, third has a fata, and fourth has a dhamma. Yaf'alu. So this is the word we created. The meaning will be third person and present tense. So third person present tense is he calls. Okay. That is the meaning of this word. Yad avu. Okay. Now, vowel is a weak letter here and it is hard to pronounce, so we adjust a little bit sound here. Okay. And the way we adjust the sound here is that this becomes yad, first two are yad, and this is pronounced this way, yad-u. Okay. The sound of the vowel is pronounced with it on the top of ayin. So yad-u. Yad-u means same thing, he calls. Now we are going to make a little bit different word in English also. So if I want to say, let him call in English, let him call, okay? What we do in English, we keep the call and add here let and him, okay, let him call, okay? how we made this in Arabic. Okay, so this is made by the rule that we put a fa in the beginning and lam. Fal. You put these two letters and keep that one. Yad'u. Okay. This fa and lam here brings the meaning of let. That's the rule. You will see in many places in the Quran, the fal comes before the word. Okay, fal yastajibu, fal yu'minu bi, many words. So fa and lam bring the meaning of let him. So fal yad'u means let him call. Okay, we are going to drag him by his forehead. Let him do something in the response. Okay, let's see what he does. So that's the meaning of let him call. Let him call his helper. Okay? We are going to start punishing him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, by doing this. Let him call his friends or his helper or his associate or anybody he wants to call. So that is the meaning of fal yad'u. Okay? So let him call. The next word is, it starts with noon, dal, and ya. Okay? And nadiyatun is helper or friends or associate. Nadiyatun means helpers or supporters. So Allah says that, okay, we are going to punish him this way. Let's see what he does. Call him, let him call his helper. See if he can, they can save him. Okay. Fal yad'u nadiya, let him call his helper or supporters. So when he's being punished, if he tries to call, it's a style of expression. Let him call his helper. Okay? So if he starts screaming and calling his, you know, fellows and helpers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we are going to call some helpers too. This is the next ayah. Okay? Which is Sanad Uzzabaniya. Let's look at these words. So the word is same, dal and waw means to call. And this time we are going to put a noon in the beginning. Okay? Noon brings the meaning of we. Okay? So we are going to put noon in the beginning and it will become nadal u. We will call. Because you can use for both present and future this noon here. So nad'u means we will call. Here we is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he's going to call his friends and helpers and supporters when he's getting punished. We are going to call. Okay, we will call. Now, seeing when this is put before future tense, it brings the meaning of soon. Seen brings the meaning of the near future. Okay? So this is near future. So when you put a seen there with a fatha, it will be we will soon call. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that soon in the future, very soon, we are going to call. What are we going to call? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word az-zubaniya. Okay? It's az-zubaniya. Zahir is dhamma on it, right?
Yeah.
Is it? Yeah, Zahir is dhamma on it.
No,
Fartais, Zabaniya.
Yeah.
Okay. Zabaniya means angels of hell. That's a particular name for the angels of hell. Angels of punishment or angels of hell are called Zabaniya Tun. Okay? The root letters are Za, Ba, and Noor. Okay. And Zabaniyatun, which you can also write down as Zabaniyatun. That means angels of hell. So you put al before that. Al means the, and al will remove one dhamma, so it will become al zabaniyatu, not tun anymore. Okay? And when you pronounce al with a za is the sound of lam, and it is pronounces az zabaniyatu. Az, when the sound of lam goes away, the sound of za becomes twice with the shadda, so it becomes az zabaniyatu. Okay, az zabaniyatu means the angels of the hell angels. Okay, now also, so what is the meaning here? Sanadhu, we will soon call. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, we will call the angels of hell. Soon. Soon means as soon as he dies. Okay? Then the angels of hell will come. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we will call not for help. Allah is not calling for help. But Allah is commanding the angels of hell, that as soon as he dies, come and take him to the punishment of hellfire. So that is what is the meaning is seen. Seen means soon, very soon, we will call the angels of hellfire. Okay? And the word is zabaniyatu, but it is coming after the verb. Okay? So when it comes after the verb, it changes into fata, it becomes zabaniyata. Okay? So we will call, so Allah says that we will soon call. We will call soon angels, the angels of hellfire. Okay, so that's the, this punishment will start. Allah here, he says that we will drag him by his forehead or forelock, and then let him call his helper. As soon as he is dead, he will be called, you know, the angels of hell will come and take care of him. Okay, so that is the meaning of Sanadhu Uzzabaniya. Okay, soon we will call the angels of hellfire. Okay, so now, you saw in the beginning the first two ayahs were about Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Next ayahs up to this point are about Abu Jahl. Okay? Then in the last ayah of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turns back to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Okay? So what is being said? Kalla. Kalla means nay. Now the address is to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Nay. whatever this person is doing to you, just ignore all that. Okay? Whatever Abu Jahl is doing, don't worry about it. Okay, nay.
Ignore
it. Ignore it. Okay? Kalla. Okay, stop and don't worry about it. Okay. Then the next word is pa, vav, and ayin, and this means to obey. To obey. Now we're going to use one more rule here, which is that if you have these three letters, fa'ala means to do. If I put a la in the beginning, and this is one of the rule of the commands, and put it ta and pronounce la tafal. Okay, you put a la in the beginning and ta in the beginning and pronounce as la tafal. This is a template, this is a rule. This means don't do. Do not do. Okay. If you want to tell someone, don't do it, you use a la in the beginning and a ta in the beginning. Use these three letters. La tafal. Don't do. Okay? So we are going to apply that rule of template of grammar on these three letters. So instead, simple thing, instead of fa, and lam, you have these three letters. Okay? So you put a la in the beginning and you put a ta in the beginning. The fata. Okay. So, and then you ta. There's one more thing will happen here. Ta, wow, and then. Okay. This word is three. Let me finish this one. This is fa'ala. Fa'ala, and we have to make another afala.
Afala.
Yeah, afala. So this will make alif waw, alif ta waw. The word ata'at, that ata'at means obeying or following someone. Okay, it's from here. Okay. So when you make the grammar from here, this comes with a okay. If the grammar of this has a fata, the grammar of this has a dhamma here. So la tufal. Okay? So now we apply that rule here. La la tu, and this one is three letters. Ta, vau, and ayin. Okay? And vau is a weak letter, it drops. So it becomes la tuti'. La tuti'u means do not obey. La tuti'u. And who means him. Do not obey him. Him is Abu Jahl here. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, La tuti'hu, do not obey him. Okay? Do not worry about Abu Jahl. Do not obey. He wants you not to pray in the Kaaba. Don't follow him, don't listen to him, don't obey him. Okay? La tuti'hu. Who is pointing to Abu Jahl? And La tuti is pointing to Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So in one word, both are being mentioned. Him, you do not follow. Here, you, this ta is you, and you is Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And who is him? It's Abu Jahl. La tuti'hu, you do not follow him. Do not obey him. Do not do what he is trying to do to you. He is trying to stop you from praying. Don't do it. La tutiyuhu. Do not obey him. Okay. Okay. This has a couple more rules here. So this fa'ala means to do. And if I ifal is a command. La tafal was don't do, ifal means do. Okay, these are different, we will have to go through these details some other time. But if al is a command, okay, do, okay. So, sajada means to make sajada, okay. And usjud means make sajada, is a command, it's an order. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala earlier mentioned that Abu Jahl said that if I see Prophet ﷺ making sajda, this is what I'm going to do. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that don't obey him and make sajda. Okay, so when you put waw before that, waw means and, and don't pronounce this alif, it becomes wasjud. And make sajda. Okay. And make sajda. Okay. The next word is qaf, ra, and qaraba. Okay, this means to be close. Qurb or qareeb means to be close. Okay, these are three letters, so they belong to the group fa'ala. Okay, so we are going to make a bigger word by adding an alif and a ta. Okay, so this will become alif, fa, ta, and la. You put alif in the beginning and a ta between the two letters. If ta'ala will make this word iqtaraba. Iqtaraba. Difference, minor difference. This means to come close. To come close. Qaraba means two things are very close to each other. But iqtaraba means with your intention you come close to someone. Okay? And this is a command. Iqtarib. Allah says come close to me. Make sajda to me and come close to me. Okay? Don't obey him. La tuti'uhu. Don't obey Abu Jahl. Doesn't matter what he says. Make sajda in the Kaaba. Okay? Because that's where he is forbidding you from making sajda. And come close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Iqtarib is a command. Okay? Come close. And come close. So that is where this surah starts. So inshallah we'll start with this one.